The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 9th chapter, text number 4 through 7, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in October of 1966 in New York.
Maya patavidam sadmam jarat abhaptamutina Mastani Sadhutani Nacha Aham Teshu Abhastita. So this verse we have discussed last day. The Lord says that all the universal planets, they are resting on my energy. The weightlessness energy, according to the modern materialistic science, how it is possible? That weightlessness we cannot manufacture. It is by nature's law, or of course modern scientists, they take nature as the supreme. But Bhagavad Gita, or the persons who are theistic, they do not take nature as the supreme. Supreme is the Lord. Behind the nature, there is Lord. We'll find in the Bhagavad Gita, Maya dhakshena prakriti svyate sacharacharam hetunanena kaunteya jagadvi parivartate. The Lord says, Maya Dhakshina means under my superintendence. Under my superintendence. So, material nature cannot play such wonderful thing unless there is hand behind it. The Lord's hand, that is to be accepted. You cannot see, you cannot give an example where material things are automatically working. There are no such example in your experience. Matter is inert, without spiritual touch, there is no possibility of acting. Matter cannot act automatically. Just like you take, for example, a nice arrangement of machine, wonderful. But unless a person touches that machinery, it cannot work. It cannot work. And what is that person? That person is a spirit. The driver, the engineer, he is a spirit. So without spiritual touch, nothing can move. It is simply ignorance that is said that matter is moving automatically. No, that is not possible. You cannot show any example within your experience or in the history, that matter is moving automatically. No. So, the Lord says that all these planets, all these universe, they are resting on my impersonal energy. So His energy is impersonal, but He is personal. He is personal. We have so many examples in our experience that a person, by his energy, he can play wonders by his energy, but still the person remains as person. Because he is expanding energy in various ways, he does not become impersonal. So if an ordinary man in this world he can expand his energy in various ways, and at the same time he can remain a person. Why not the Supreme Personality of Godhead? So, that impersonal feature of the Lord is his energy. But the Lord himself is a person. Nitya nityana chetana chetanana. Just like we are person, so he is also person. But he is the supreme person. We are all dependent person. That is the difference. He is the supreme person. The Lord says again, Matam asthani bhutani pasame yogamai saram. Now you can say, Lord is maybe overburdened because he is bearing so many, just like with our material conception. Just we have seen the picture of at last one stout man is bearing a big planet on his head. So we may think, Lord is bearing so many big, huge planets on his shoulders, he must be troubled. No. The Lord says, Nacha masthani bhutani pasame yogamai saram. Although they are in my energy, still they are not in me. Pasame yogamai saram. This is my mystic power. Pasame yogamai saram. Bhūtavit nasa bhūtastha mamātmā bhūtabhāvanā. I am maintaining all these living entities. Bhūtavit, bhūtastha, and my energy is all pervading. Still, I am not there. Tasame yogamaśyam. This is his mystic power. Nano ati guru bhāraṁ bhātaste mahān kheda sadhiti cittaha ghatādo udaka aniva bhāra-bhūtāni ca bhūtāni sanskrishtāni maina santi. Tarhi mastāni sarva-bhūtāni tukti viruddheti cittatraha pasyeti. So this is the wonderful power, inconceivable power. That he is in everywhere, but still he is aloof. He is aloof from that place. We can feel his energy, but we cannot see. Because in this material life, we cannot see. But when we develop our spiritual quality, we sanctify our senses, then even within his energy we can see. Take for example, just like electric power is transmitted everywhere, there is wiring. Now, if some electrician is there, he can take electric power from anywhere and utilize electricity. Similarly, his energy is spread all over the universe. When we are transcendentally situated, just like when we become the electrician, then from anywhere we can see God eye to eye. Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena, that creation, spiritualization of the senses is possible by devotion and service and love. Vimanyan Shrita Bhakti Vilochanena Santas Sadaiva Ridayesu Vilokai. Therefore, as the Lord says, Maya Tadamidam Sadmam Jagatam Bhakta Murtinam. The Lord is all pervading all over the universe. Therefore, He is within the stove, He is within the earth, He is within the water, He is within the earth, everywhere. Therefore, if we make an image of God from anything, either of water, either of stone, either of anything, that is not doll. That is also God. If we have got sufficient devotion, that image also will speak with me. Because God is everywhere. Maya tasamitam sadmam. I am spread all over, impersonal. But if we make his personal form from anything, either from the stone or from earth or from wood or from anything, or if we create an image of God within myself, there are eight kinds of images recommended in the Shastra, in the Vedic literature. So any kind of images can be worshipped, because God is everywhere. You can say that why God should be worshipped in images, not in his original form, spiritual form. Yes. That may be a question. But I cannot see spiritual form. That is my difficulty. My senses are so imperfect that I cannot see God immediately in his spiritual form. Therefore, out of his causeless mercy, he appears before you as you can see him. We cannot see just now with our material eyes, except stone, earth, wood, something tangible. Therefore, he becomes, these forms are called archavatar, incarnation of archa. Conveniently presented by the Supreme Lord so that we can actually see. But the result will be that in the image, if you concentrate your energy and if you love and offer your devotion, that will be responded, even from that image. There are many instances. Very many, many instances. I will cite one story. It is a very interesting story. If you go to India, you will find one nice temple in Orissa. It is called the Temple of Witness Gopal, Sakhi Gopal, Witness Gopal. This Gopal was situated in a temple at Vrindavan. Now two Brahmins, one young and one old, they went to visit Vrindavan, the place of pilgrimage. And the old man, because at that time there was no railway, the journey was very hard sea, the old man felt very obliged and he began to say to the young man, "My dear boy, you have done so much nice service to me, I am obliged to you. So I must return that service. I must give some reward." So the young man said, "Oh, my dear sir, you are old man, you are just like my father, so it is my duty to serve you, to give you all comforts. I don't require any reward." Formerly the boys were so gentle, and still there are many boys like that. So the old man also thought that, "No, I am obliged to you, I must reward you." So he promised that I shall get you married with my youngest daughter. Now the old man was a very rich man, and the young man was not rich, he was poor, although he was Brahmin, learned. So he said, "Sir, you are promising, you don't promise it, because your kinsmen, your family men will not agree. I am poor man, and you are rich man, you are aristocratic. So it will be not, this marriage will not take place. Don't promise in that way before the deity." it is not good, because it is there. But he was found faith that Krishna is hearing. And because the talks were going on in the temple, so it will not be fulfilled. No, because the old man became still more persistent, so my daughter I shall offer you, who can permit me? So in this way, when they came back, one day the old man proposed to his eldest son that your youngest sister should be married with that boy that I promised. The eldest son of that old man became very angry. Oh, how you have selected that boy to be husband of my sister? He's unfit, he's poor man, he's not so educated. Oh, this cannot take place. He did not agree. Then the mother of the girl, he came to the old man. Oh, if you get my daughter married with that boy, then I shall commit suicide. Now the old man is perplexed. Then one day, the boy was anxious that the old man promised before the Gita. Now he's not coming. So he one day came to his house. Well, my dear sir, you promised before the Lord Krishna, and you are not fulfilling your promise. How is that? The old man was silent, because you are saying to Krishna that I am now worthless if I persist in offering this daughter to this boy. Now there will be great trouble in my family, so we are silent. So in the meantime, the eldest son came out and he began to call it, oh, you plundered my father in the place of pilgrimage. You gave him some LSD or something, intoxication. You took all the money from my father. Now you say that he has promised to offer you my younger sister, you fool. He began to say like that. Then all the neighboring gentlemen, they go, what is the trouble? There is so much howling. Do you think, sir, that this boy is fit for my sister? We are aristocratic family and this or that, so on. So, the young man said, the young man could understand, the old man is still agreeable, but his sons and family members, as he suggested, they are not agreeable. So he explained the whole thing before all the gentlemen who came, that this is the fact. Now he promised, now for the sake of his son and wife, he cannot fulfill his promise. This was the promise before the law. Then in the meantime, the old man's eldest son was atheist. He voluntarily says, well, if your God comes and gives witness, then I shall offer my sister to you. But he was confident that God will come. He said, yes, I shall ask God, I shall ask Krishna to come and give witness. Now, before all gentlemen this was done, then the young man said, all right, let us now come to agreement that I shall call Krishna from Vrindavan to give witness in this matter. And when he comes, he will have to. All the other gentlemen, they also persisted, so there was some agreement. So this boy went again to Vrindavan, his Gopal, and he prayed that, sir, you have to go with me. He was so staunch devotee, just like talking with friends. He did not think that is a statue, it is image. He is God. That was his conviction. So God said, how do you think that a statue can go with you? I am a statue. I cannot go. Then this boy replied, well, if a statue can speak, he can go on. Then Krishna said, all right, I shall go with you. Then there was some arrangement that you will not see me, but I will go with you. I will go with you, and you will hear the sound of my nopur. A nopur is an instrument which is fixed up in the leg of Krishna. It sounds a chin, 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 just like. So, he was going with him, and daily he was offering some foodstuff, taking alms from the village. In this way he was coming. But when he came in the precincts of the village, of his own village, he could not hear the sound of the Nupur. So he saw that, oh, where is Krishna? He saw that statue is there. The statue is standing. So he informed all the villagers that Lord has come to be witness. And it is about some thousand years before this thing happened. People were convincing, yes, there was no such a big statue this boy could not bring. So they believed, and there was a temple constructed by the king of that country, and still that temple is there, and it is named, the Lord is named as Sakhi Gopal. Sakhi Gopal, Gopal means, Gopal is the name of Krishna's boyhood. So, because he came to give witness in that controversy, so that temple is still there. So, the whole idea is, the statue, because God is everywhere. See, he's also in statue. God is everywhere. How can you say that he's not in statue? He is also in statue. So, it is my devotion. It is my qualification that I can induce that statue to speak with me. Just like the same, if I am electrician, then I can fit any electrical instrument or machine or light from the electric energy which is all over. Similarly, God's energy, He is present everywhere. When we are advanced in spiritual consciousness, then we can see God everywhere. Maya tatam idam sattvam jagat abhaktam vipina. So, He is everywhere and He is not everywhere also. Just like you have got this post box. The post box means the post office. You put your letter, it will go to the destination. Because it is authorized. Similarly, the authorized deity established in a temple that is worshipped by thousands and thousands of men in India still. There was an occasion to worship the temple of Jagannath at Puri. In one day, about 600,000 people assembled there. In one day. So still, India, they have got this faith and they worship the deity in the temple. There are thousands and thousands of temples and they receive the result. They are happy. So, if we are prepared to accept these things and do according to the devotional rules and regulations, then it is possible for us to see God anywhere and everywhere. It requires our own qualification. But at the same time, nacha masthani bhutani pasthami yogamaisaram. Bhutavit nacha bhutastam mamatma bhutabhavana. So, he is that energy is spread all over the universe, all over the world. And by his energy, he can present anywhere and everywhere, but at the same time, he is not in everywhere and everywhere. The conclusion is, when his devotee is there, he can manifest himself in everywhere and anywhere, but when there is no devotee, he is not there. All his energy is there. There are many instances. Prahlad Maharaj, he saw Krishna from the pillar. There was, that's a long story, I shall decide some other day. So, God can manifest Himself from anywhere and everywhere, because He is present everywhere. But He requires my qualification to see. It requires my qualification. If I am qualified enough, Priman Manasurita Bhakti Vilochane, if I have developed such consciousness, such love, transcendental love for God, then I can see Him everywhere and anywhere. Any place. From picture, from statue, in statue, without picture, within myself, in air, in water, everywhere I can see. That is the process. He's giving a nice example here. Jathakasa sito nittanga vayu sarvatra go maha. Tatha sarvani bhutani masthani tu upadharaya. He says, jatha akasa sito nittanga vayu. The air is situated in the sky. Everyone knows it, that air is passing or blowing within the sky. And nittang vāyu sarvatra go mahān, and it is blowing everywhere. You cannot find out any place where there is no air. If you want to drive out air, then you have to make by machine, by vacuum, airtight. Otherwise, air is everywhere. Jathākāsa sthito nittanga vāyu sarvatra go mahān, as the air is spread all over, anywhere. Similarly, tathā sarvāni bhūtāni masthāni tu udhārayo. Similarly, everything that is there, that is existing, it is within me. It is within me. Sarva bhūtāni kaunteya prakritiṁ jānti māmika. And when this manifestation, material manifestation is dissolved, then where does it take place? Where does it go? He says, sarva bhutani kaunteya prakritiṁ jānti māmikāṁ. My prakriti, my nature is manifested, and when the time is finished, that nature is hunda. Kalpakhaya punastani kalpoda kalpadu visjami aham. In this way, at a certain interval, this material manifestation is exhibited, and again it is punda. This material manifestation is sometimes it is created and sometimes it goes into the nature of the Lord. But spiritual creation is not like that. Spiritual creation is permanent. In the material creation, everything is temporary, non-permanent. Just like this body. This body is created. Take for example, in our personal self, we are spiritual spark, fragmental. We have several times discussed this point, that we are all spiritual spark, fragmental part of the Supreme Lord. As we are creating our body, and it is finishing, and again I am creating my body, and again finishing. That is a fact. I have created this body, you have created your body. You are a small particle, atomic, physical portion. And when you are put into the womb of your mother, you get your body and develop. Everything is developing like that. Similarly, as we are developing our own body, unless the spiritual spark is there within the body will not develop. This example we have given several times. The child comes out. If the child is dead, no, it will not develop. But if it has got life, if the spiritual spark is there, the child grows to a man. Similarly, the whole universe, the whole material manifestation, they are going on the presentation, on the presence of the Supreme Lord. As we have got our spiritual presence within this body, similarly, this universe is also containing the God's representative as Paramatma, Kirodasai Vishnu. That information we get. Due to his presence, the material existence is there. just due to my presence, the body is existing. And as soon as I am out of this body, the body will go to hell. Similarly, this material manifestation is due to the presence of God. Otherwise, there is no such existence. So, sometimes he manifests and sometimes he does not. This is going on. Sarvabhutani kaunteya prakriti janti mamikam. Similarly, I wound up. It goes to me. Again, kalpakhaya punastanami kalpadu visyamaham. Then after certain interval, when there is again kalpa, each creation is called a kalpa. Kalpantasthaino guna. Each creation is called a kalpa. So there are many kalpas. You cannot calculate what is the age of one kalpa. One hint is there in the Bhagavad Gita that in each kalpa, the one day of Brahma, that sahasrayuga pajyantam marahajyat brahmano vidu, 400,000 of years into 1,000, that makes one day of Brahma. Similarly, he lives for 100 years, and after each 100 years, the kalpa is finished, and again another kalpa begins. That is the calculation from Vedic literature.